Sabbath greetings to everyone. It is, in times like these, you really appreciate the opportunity to worship together. At least I do. And it's good to see everyone here. Welcome to each of you. And may we each gain the blessing for which we have come. May because we have been here, we will leave stronger, more fully committed to our God and Savior. One thing just to kind of remind those of you about our offering. We don't utilize the offering plate, passing it among you, just as a precautionary measure. There is an offering plate at the back in the foyer of the church on that table. So as you go through out the exit doors and to your right, you will see an offering plate there. And our offering this week is Conference Faith Advance. And I kind of asked what that is, and it's a offering that goes for Central California Conference. One of the benefits of that offering, one of the functions of the money that goes into that offering that we should be very interested in hearing about here at Monterey Bay Academy Church and the constituent church of VHM Christian School, is that there are funds that are used from those monies to assist with people who don't have the financial resources to send their children to VHM or to Monterey Bay Academy. So it is a very important offering, plus there are other functions, other services for that offering that I don't know a great deal about, but it's in general, it's a fund for the conference. I guess it's not an evangelism offering, but many evangelistic things are done with those monies. And if now that's what I was wondering, and I didn't catch that. So there are three entities: Monterey Bay Academy, Camp Awana, and Soquel. Those are benefits. Thank you for helping me to understand that. Let's bow our heads as we begin our worship together. Almighty God, it is indeed a privilege to come to the house of the Lord to praise and worship the Creator of the universe. Help us to realize what an awesome opportunity it is for us to talk to the Creator and to know that He knows us, He knows our name, and He loves us each deeply. May we gain a real spiritual blessing from having been here. And guide and bless every aspect of our service today. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. We have something really special we haven't done for quite a while that it's going to be the very next part of our service, and that is the children's story. Now, we don't have an awful lot of young kids, but we do have one that I understand is really excited. In fact, he's back there waving his hand, so I'll be sure and notice that he's young, that he's going to come up for the story. So, Max, welcome, and you can bring your sisters if they want to come with you, or you can come by yourself. Come up for our children's story, and you just go right over there, and you will be assisted in this. You can sit down
right over here, Max. Come right over here. All right. Good morning. How are you this morning? Can you remind me how old you are? 6? Wow, when did you turn 6? You've gotten big. I was thinking you were still four when I was talking to my husband about it. But we're going to go and we're going to pack for going on a camping trip. Do you like to go camping? Yeah? Sometimes you might camp in your backyard. Yeah? So I bet you had to pack some things up to take out there, right? And some things you might need to take is maybe you need some clothes if you're going to be overnight, right? You might need a water bottle. Yeah, that could be something you might need. Oh, maybe some snacks or some food. Yeah. What are some other things you might take? Especially as a little kid, you might choose to take one of your stuffed animals with you. And you have new ones? This one's all the way from Nebraska. It's a great beanie baby that a friend of mine gave me. Oh, you might take some Band-Aids or some things to in case you, skin your knee or something like that. Yes, okay. Oh, you might take a book so that you can read. Oh, it might get cold, so you might need a Pacific Union College beanie hat. Let's see, what else might we take? In my house, you probably would have a rubber ducky, and so you might need to take it. So you'd have all your things you would need to take. Can you think of anything else that you might want to take on a camping trip?
My tidal light.
Oh, your light, so you can see. Scared of the dark, so you can see at night. You know, and these are all things that are important to take when we're camping, right? And pack them up, and for different trips in life, if you were going to climb Half Dome, you would take maybe some different things, or if you were going to go camp at the beach, or maybe you'd take a toy to play with or something. But when we get ready to, and as we are here on this earth, and we're getting ready to pack to go home to spend time with Jesus, there's actually only one thing that he needs from us. All of these things are just going to stay here, but he needs from us, and the only thing he needs is for us to give him our heart. And so as you go through each week and you go to different things and you pack stuff up, remember to always give your heart to Jesus each and every day, because ultimately that's all that he needs from you. You have a good day now.
Pretty neat children's story. And yeah, a lot of us definitely can relate with the camping and what we need to bring. His little nightlight. He said a turtle nightlight because it's a little turtle and projects stars. So it's like, ooh, it's neat too. I know, it's pretty cool. All right, so good morning once again. I'm so used to when I'm in front of like people, because, a teacher, to keep the mask on, so now it would be kind of awkward and feel different to weird to take it off. So should I take it off, leave it on? I know I was struggling with that last week too, but I'll try, I don't know. Woo, there I can see. Growing up my beard, I'm catching up to you, Mr. Rouse, with a white. All right. If you have your Bibles, I invite you to open them to Ephesians 4. Ephesians chapter 4, and we're looking at verses 1 and 2. Once again, the fourth chapter of Ephesians, verses 1 and 2. And I'll be reading out of the New King James Version. So as I read out loud, you can follow along silently. Again, Ephesians 4, 1 and 2 says, I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love. As we get ready to pray, I know we've done this in the past and we're a small group. Are there any spoken prayer requests that you would like to make known so the rest of the church family could pray for in their own prayers? If you have any spoken prayer requests.
Yes.
for Lynn Neubauer and her family, the kids, I have Emma goes to MBA, and William is in my class, and Dad, of course. So keep them, yeah, definitely in your prayers, in our prayers, yeah. All right. And of course, God knows the silent prayer requests, the things we have in our hearts. All right, let's bow our heads for prayer, and I'll lead us out in prayer. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this Sabbath day that you've given us, for this opportunity we have to be able to come together in person to hear you, to hear this message that you've inspired, Lord. Please let the message touch our hearts and help it to draw us, help us to be drawn closer to you, Lord. In a special way, we ask for the Neubauer family. Please bless them as they're going through difficult circumstances of loss. So please comfort and stay with them and help us, inspire us to know how we can be a help and a support as well, Lord. Help us to have a good Sabbath day. Stay with each one of our families, each of our own personal needs, and prayer requests, Lord, that we have. Guide us and keep us safe. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, and happy Sabbath. I think most of you might know who I am here, but my name is Cindy Palmer. I'm from the Phoenix Camelback Church in Phoenix, Arizona, and my daughters Stevie and Tori both came here to school. So if any of you knew Stevie, she was always barefoot. She got that from me. So my reasoning for singing up here barefoot is because God asked Moses to take his shoes off because he was on holy ground. So I feel that I'm on holy ground, and truly, I truly feel that God comes through my feet and fills me with his love. So it's not out of disrespect, it's actually out of respect for God.
There will come a day. Good morning, and thank you very much, Cindy, and thank you so very much, Donna and John, and those who have helped put this service together. I so appreciate being here with you this morning, and I hope that you appreciate being here. Feels like a gift. Feels like we're being naughty almost a little bit. Like, well, we're actually meeting here in person. Praise God for that. I'm glad that we do have the freedom, and we are doing so, observing the protocols of the state of California, and we are observing those protocols because we do want people to feel safe and to be healthy when they come here. Well, I'm trying to remember how many weeks ago that I actually gave a sermon. You know, things get mixed up when you're doing recordings midweek for a sermon on the weekend. You know, as a pastor, not being able to meet together on Sabbath morning has been a very disturbing thing. It's like one of the anchor points of your rhythm of week to week that gets taken out of the way. And, you know, I don't know, doing Zoom Sabbath school in your pajamas at home just doesn't feel exactly right. There's something wrong with that. So I don't know how many weeks ago it was. I shared a sermon on unity, and it was recorded. And I shared that sermon, and after I started thinking about some of the things that I had said in that sermon, and I started thinking in a general terms, you know, there's an awful lot of things that we as pastors, sometimes as elders, and even as church members, they're cliches and they're spiritual truths that we throw out. And I realize that they are very ethereal, that we don't know how to make practical use of a lot of the things that we talk about. I think about what the Apostle Paul said in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 16. The Apostle Paul says, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh." Okay, well, that sounds good, but how does that work? And you start thinking about it in terms of the students here on campus and our kids. You know, how many of these spiritual concepts that we throw out there and we expect that they're just going to stick on the refrigerator door, but they just keep flying right over the head? I mean, how do you tell your 14-year-old, walk by the Spirit and you won't gratify the desires of the flesh? How does that work? I mean, when it gets out there, they're with their friends, how does that work? How do we put this into practice? And I realize that this is really a big issue in Christianity, that we sometimes throw out terms, but we don't have practical ways of making it work or are actually putting it into our lives. So how do you go about living the Christian life in such a way that you're actually doing the living and the willing and the choosing? But yet it's really the Holy Spirit or Christ who is doing the living and the doing, the acting, the choosing. And you're doing, and they're doing it through your willingness and your acting and your doing. How does it work? How can we make Christianity real? And I started thinking about it. I felt the Lord put a burden on my heart to just give some very basic things that we can use, not just one time when we make a decision for Christ, but things that we can use every day in living a Christian life. Does that sound like maybe it would be worth our while just to consider what are some practical things that we can use every day for the situations that you face and that I face, so that I will be living like a believer, like a follower of Jesus Christ? What does that look like? It's a big deal. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:10, he says, "By the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them," speaking of other people who were called apostles, though it was not I, "but the grace of God that is with me." Everyone listening to this right now should say, well, how do you do that? How do you work harder and in the end say, it was the grace of God that was working through me? How do we make practical application of that? What's my part and what's God's part? Paul said to the Philippians, he says, and this one really is a conundrum, But Paul said to the Philippians, the believers at Philippi, chapter 2, and I'll be reading verses 12 and 13. He says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to do for his good pleasure. That's a tough one, because it says that we are to work out. He says we're to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. We have to struggle. We have to wrestle with what it means to be a believer and to walk and to follow Christ. But then he says it's God who works in you, both to will and to do for his good pleasure. And so where does my striving end and Christ's striving begin? And where does faith work and where does presumption begin? How do we do that? Peter said it, 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 11. He says this, whoever serves as a servant of Christ. And we talked about that in our Sabbath school, this lesson about being a servant, that Christ was the perfect servant to come and serve humanity for salvation. But Peter says, whoever serves, let him serve by the strength that God supplies. Now, how do you do that? I mean, you're serving, but it's God who's doing the working. And then Paul says this, Galatians chapter 5, verse 18. He says, be led by the Spirit. A few verses later in verse 22, he says, bear the fruit of the Spirit. And then in Galatians 5, 22, he says, keep in step with the Spirit. How do we tell our kids how this works? And I'm saying our kids because I think that many times we as Christians struggle with what that means. How does that work? How do we let God work in us? Now, I want to say this. I want to preach by the Spirit. You know, I could take up time and space standing up here, and I may have a nice little sermon, and you guys say, oh, that was great, Pastor. Thank you very much. That was a nice sermon. That's not what I want. I want us to, in this experience of my preaching from God's Word, I want there to be the power of the Spirit in what is said so that there are changes, there's an impact, that there is growth, spiritual growth, the greater ability to trust God and to walk by faith. I want that to be a result of what I do up here. I want to preach in the strength that God supplies. I want to preach in such a way that I can say it's not I, but the grace of God was with me. Amen? That is what I really want to do. So I believe that there are some very practical things. And so if you think that this is too basic, wonderful. Then, you know, help me understand how to get to where you are if you understand all these things perfectly. But there's something that is bedrock. I think this is bedrock for every person who is following Jesus Christ. And you've got to do this, and we have to do this, and I have to do this every day. And the first thing that I have to do, number one, I have to admit. And what do I have to admit? I have to admit that without Christ, I can do nothing. And I mean that. There is nothing of any lasting significance, of any eternal value that will ever come from what you can bring apart from Christ and that I can bring apart from Christ. So we're talking, and the problem is that we think, you know, we wake up in the morning, you know, our alarm clock gets us up and we get ready. We know the things we have to do for the day. We have our checklist, whether we're a staff at Monterey Bay Academy or we have some job out in industry. You know, we know the steps and we go through all these things and we do it over and over and over again. And we get to the place where we feel like it's all us. I'm doing this. I'm making the choice to, you know, oh yeah, God gave me life, so now I have to get up and I have to go to work and I have to do these things, no matter what it is. But I have to admit that spiritually, in terms of anything of lasting eternal value, anything of that will have to come from Christ. And of course, we have this well-known passage of Scripture, John 15, verse 5. Jesus says, I am the vine, and you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. I would say that more of the failing of the Christian community in the world today hinges on not understanding this one bedrock principle, and that is that without Christ, I can do nothing. Isaiah 64:6 says this, that we are all like an unclean thing, and all of our righteous acts are like filthy rags. What we do on our own, what we choose to do on our own, what we give ourselves credit for having done on our own spiritually amounts to nothing. It's worthless. It's actually a hindrance to the spiritual walk. So the first thing you and I have to do every day, maybe many times during the day, is admit that I can do nothing apart from Christ. When you're tempted, when you feel like you're being drawn away by this or that or the other, even if it's not a moral issue, the first thing that should come to mind is that I need Christ in order to meet this challenge. I must have Christ. Otherwise, I will not fail. I will absolutely fail. So the first thing we have to do is admit that we can do nothing apart from Christ. The second thing, and this is not super, hopefully this isn't too scientific. The second thing I need to do is I need to pray. We need to admit to God in prayer that we can do nothing, and we need to ask Jesus for help. That's what we teach our kids, right? If you're having this difficulty, pray to Jesus. Are we praying to Jesus when we meet difficulties during the day? Sometimes I realize in my own life that prayer is not my first resort. It's kind of like the last resort, you know, when I've done everything else. When I can't find the car keys that I just had a few minutes ago and I put them someplace safe, I can't find that place. You know, I will tear the house apart. And then finally, it's like, well, did you ask God to help you find those keys? How many times have I done that and I found, you know, I'm like, God, forgive me for making your help my last resort when it should be my first resort. Jesus said this, ask and you will receive. Isn't that what Jesus said? Ask and you will receive. Are we asking? As the book of James says, you know, a lot of the times we don't receive is because we don't ask. I had a friend of mine who was so cynical about prayer and not getting what he wanted. He says, you know, I just say same as yesterday when it comes time to pray. You know, since God already knows all this stuff, why do I need to tell him? We need to ask, brothers and sisters. We need to ask for the small things and for the big things. James 4:2, you do not have because you do not ask. Psalm 50, verse 15, call upon me in the day of trouble. I would say we need to use this a lot because we are in the days of trouble. We're in the days where there's so much confusion, where there's a lack of unity in society in general, and sometimes even in our own families. We need to pray and ask that God will help us in the day of trouble. So I asked before I preached, Lord, please help me to say something that will be an encouragement to my brothers and sisters, something that will be some solid footing for them to get traction on in their walk of faith. So we need to first admit that we need Christ, then we need to pray. And specifically, we need to pray God's promises, which leads to the third thing. We need to trust what God has promised. Do we trust what God says he will do, that he will do? Do you claim God's promises? We need to claim his promises. God has given us awesome promises. It says in the book of 2 Peter, we have these awesome promises that God has given us, that by those things we can become partakers of the heavenly nature. We need to pray. We need to trust that God will ask, that he will answer the prayer prayed in the prayer of faith for something that he has promised. I like this. We read it this morning in our Sabbath school lesson. I didn't tell David, but he was stealing my thunder this morning. Isaiah 41:10, I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you. Do you ever claim that promise? Do you know that you need God to uphold you in what you're facing? Are there problems out there? Are there temptations? Is it a financial situation? Is it a relationship issue? Are you claiming God's promise that God will help you, that God will strengthen you, that God is the one who's upholding you? I claim that, and one that I claim a lot is the one found in that little book of Jude where God promises that he will keep us, that it's God's strong arm that keeps us. You know, it's not us keeping us. It's God who's keeping us. You want to know why you have faith this morning, whether it's a little or it's a lot? It's because God is keeping you in that walk of faith. I've used that so many times. I love Isaiah 41:10. I claim it often. There's that promise in James chapter 1. What is it? You remember what it says in James chapter 1? If any of you lacks wisdom, what does it say? We're to ask for it. Do you need wisdom, or do you have enough wisdom on your own that you don't really need to tap into, you know, what God might give? Oh, brothers and sisters, we need God's wisdom to know, to discern between what's right and what's not as right. We need discernment to know how to meet questions that students may ask. We need wisdom to know how to respond to our neighbors. We need wisdom to know whether I should do this or that. And if we ask, God gives generously without finding fault. And it will be given to you. It will be given to you. That's God's promise. I need that wisdom. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, Paul says, God promises that I will make all grace abound to you. I don't know about you, but I need more grace in my life. Do you need more grace? You know what grace is? It's a love of God being manifested in a very tangible way. It's God's love being poured out on you as you live your life day by day. I need more of God's grace. And here's a promise. I will make all grace abound to you. Philippians 4:19. I will supply every need. You know, when I'm preparing for sermon, I claim this promise in Isaiah 55:11. My word will not come back to me empty. I claim that promise. I don't want God's words to, you know, bounce off and not do anything. God's saying, when my word goes out, it does not come back empty. It accomplishes what I sent it out to do. So I need to first admit that I need Jesus, that I can do nothing apart from him. And then I need to pray, telling God what's on my heart. I need to trust God by claiming his promises specifically. And now I need to do the fourth thing. And this is important. The fourth thing that we need to do, we need to act. We need to move forward. The servant of the Lord said it's oftentimes much worse to not make a decision once we have prayed for wisdom. She said we should pray for wisdom and then we should act on it, asking God to reveal to us if we're going in the wrong direction. And God has promised to do that. But it's much better to move out in faith than to say, well, I'm just going to sit here until I see the lightning bolt. I'm going to stay right here until I see the offering on the altar consumed with the lightning bolt from heaven. Oh, brothers and sisters, we need to move out. In fact, we need to act on God's word. Paul wrote to the Ephesians in chapter 6, verse 13. He says, therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. You know, we as Christians need to stand our ground in the culture of today. Our Christianity, our beliefs, our whole idea of seeing what's happening on earth is being challenged. And being challenged in a very dramatic, in a very confrontational, in-your-face kind of way. And Paul is saying here that we need to stand in the day of evil. He said that you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. But it requires us making a decision to act on it, to move in faith. Are we moving out in faith in what we believe as a Christian? So now, what are the four things so far? We need to admit that we can do nothing apart from Christ. We need to pray, asking God for help. We need to trust God's promises. We need to go and move forward in faith. And now the final thing, we need to do one final thing. We need to thank God when he shows up. We need to say, thank you, God, for answering my prayer. Thank you. Even if it didn't turn out like you thought it was going to, we need to thank God that he was in whatever happened. Maybe you learned a lesson. Maybe I learned a lesson. Ephesians 5:20, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Philippians 4:6, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation. How many situations? He says, in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. 1 Chronicles 16:34, give thanks to the Lord for he is good. His love endures forever. Can we say amen to that? And I say amen. His love endures forever. His love will never stop holding you and holding me. Colossians 3:17, Paul says, and whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And I love this, 1 Thessalonians 5:18. Paul again says, it's a theme through all of his writings. He says, in everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. There it is. It's easy. And you're thinking, well, Pastor, give us something new, something we haven't heard before. There is nothing new. There is probably nothing that you haven't heard before. But we stumble. Sometimes we struggle in our walk of faith because we don't know how to make Christianity real in this situation. When there's peer pressure, when there is pressure brought by family members, when there's pressure brought about by situations. And by the way, there's some situations that put a lot of pressure on. Can I just be really transparent with you this morning and share something personally that happened to me? Where what we're talking about this morning saved me? I just want to share that. It was about 3 weeks ago. I didn't tell my wife this either. About 3 weeks ago, I was writing to my office in Santa Cruz. And so, like a lot of you, I get on San Andreas Road and I go down to past East Cape and I go to Highway 1 and I get on the on-ramp going north on Highway 1 to get to whatever part of Santa Cruz I'm going. I get off on Morrissey. Yeah, I know you take Soquel. Okay, we won't argue about that. So I'm going down Highway 1 and I'm on my motorcycle. And it's about 8:30 in the morning, and what is the phenomena that we experience many times on Highway 1 North at about 8 to 9 o'clock in the morning? It's called what? Commute traffic. You all know about it. We love that stuff, don't we? That is the only benefit I can say about this whole pandemic, is that for a period of time, Highway 1 North was amazing at 8 o'clock in the morning. You remember those days? Well, it's kind of gotten back to business as usual now. I was traveling there, and I think, as I recall, I was getting close to Bay Porter Street and 41st Avenue exit, and the traffic had gotten really slow, and so I know you guys don't understand this, but I actually was splitting the lane, which I can legally do here in the state of California, and so I'm moving between the traffic, the right and left lane of traffic, right there on the center line, and the traffic is going maybe 2 miles an hour, 3 miles an hour, maybe a little faster depending on what part, but it's going pretty slow, and so I'm going carefully, and the guidelines from the CHP are that the person going past traffic not go any faster than 10 miles an hour faster than the traffic beside them. And so I was observing that, and I was going between two vehicles. And there was a car to my left, and on my right-hand side, there was a black Chevy pickup truck, long bed, 4x4. It had a lift kit, had tires sticking out about that far out of the, which is okay. It's just a monster truck type thing going down the road. And as I was moving between these two vehicles, the truck was moving over and squeezing me between the vehicle, and I glanced up, and the person in the truck was actually looking at me as he was coming over. And so I had that decision, that panic, do I get on the brake and try to get behind this? But I was actually a little bit further than halfway, so one of the good things that a motorcycle has, it accelerates pretty quickly, and so you can get out of a situation using that. And so I hit the throttle, and I was just about to clear this vehicle on my right when he squeezed me to the point that he hit my hard case with his left front tire. And it made my motorcycle wobble in between the lines of traffic. But a motorcycle has actually amazing stability because of the gyroscopic effect, and it wants to stay upright. And so I was able to recover, and I said, thank you, God, for saving me. As I got out from under, beside this vehicle that had squeezed me. And so I was thankful, and I was just saying, thank you, God, for saving me. But you know, the next thing that happens when the immediate panic is over, maybe not in your mind, but in my mind, I started processing what had happened, and I started getting angry. And my blood pressure, I'm sure, was impressive as I started to think about what had happened, because it wasn't an accident. It was a malicious act. And I started imagining how good it might feel to have my fingers around the throat of this person. And so I was giving in to, and I was going with the emotions of what had happened in anger. And then the Holy Spirit started speaking to me, saying, "Yes, what happened to you is wrong, but do you want to carry this garbage around inside of you, knowing what it will do to you and wreck your peace?" And I had to say, "No." And the Holy Spirit continued, as the Holy Spirit does, and says, "Wouldn't you want to forgive that brother because of how Christ has forgiven you and all the things that you have done, which are much worse than that?" And I had to admit, yes, I want to forgive this brother because Christ has forgiven me. And I want, I'm not saying that what happened is okay or that it's right, but I am releasing carrying that stuff around with me, and I'm giving it to Christ. And I prayed, I was able to pray and say, "God, I forgive this person, and I just pray that you would speak to his heart. I pray that I get to meet him some other place, at some other time, and have the possibility of spending eternity with him in heaven." And I'm telling you this not because I'm a strong person, not because I'm, "Oh, look what I did." I did nothing. If I had gone with my feelings, I would not be able to talk about it this morning because I would still be so angry and incensed over what had happened. But instead, I have peace this morning. Praise God, I have peace this morning because God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, allowed me in a situation that was beyond my abilities as a Christian, as a pastor, as a person on planet Earth to deal with in a positive way. But I have peace now. Now, I had to go through this scenario a few more times because during the day, guess what? As I go through the day, of course, you know, your mind goes back. Oh, remember what happened this morning. And so, you know, I had to kind of run through it more than once. But after a while, the giving it to Jesus, the giving it up at the foot of the cross becomes a habit. And now I don't even, I mean, I'm sharing it with you this morning. Again, not to make me look good because there's nothing good about me. But I am sharing it this morning to give praise and glory and honor to God, who wants to have us live in a practical way. And so we need to admit that apart from Christ, we can do nothing. We need to pray about what's going on in our life. We need to trust in God's promises, claiming them for ourselves. And we need to act on it. We need to put it in motion. It's not just a theory. We need to actually incorporate it into the decisions we make and how we see the rest of the world. And then we need to thank God. And so I'm thanking God this morning that he made his power real in my life. And we need practical Christianity because there are things coming at us. There are things that are going to happen to you this next week that you have no idea about and that I have no idea about. But God knows, and God has the grace and the power to have you be his representative, his ambassador to a community that is looking for evidence as to whether or not we really have been with Christ or not. And it's my prayer for you that you will incorporate these very, very simple things. And by the way, you can run through these five things. You can go through those things in a matter of a minute or less. You can go through those whole thing. And you can claim God's promise. And you can act upon it. And then you can be thanking God. Spending all your time. You know what? You should waste all your time thanking God for what he's done. I hope that you spend more time there than any other place. But as I was preparing to share these thoughts with you this morning, it reminded me of a song that I heard many years ago. it was a song that was written by Michael Card. It was performed by Amy Grant. She performed, you probably never heard of her. You guys are laughing. But that song is called I Have Decided. And it goes like this. I have decided I'm going to live like a believer. Turn my back on the deceiver. I'm going to live what I believe. I have decided being good is just a fable. I just can't because I'm not able. I'm going to leave it to the Lord. There's a wealth of things that I profess. I said that I believed, but deep inside, I never changed. I guess I'd been deceived because a voice inside kept telling me that I'd change by and by, but the Spirit made it clear to me that kind of life is a lie. So forget about the game of being good and your self-righteous pain, because the only good inside your heart is the good that Jesus brings. And when the world begins to see you change, don't expect them to applaud. Just keep your eyes on him and tell yourself, I become the work of God. And now Cindy is going to share that song with us in closing.
This is-
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father in heaven, I'm so thankful, Father, that we do not have to figure it out on our own, but that the Holy Spirit is there to lead us and guide us into all truth. And Lord, as we wrestle with how to live a life that is pleasing to you, how to make choices, how to deal with situations in a way that honors you, Lord, help us to realize that it is God who works in us both to will and to do for your good pleasure. So, Father, please send your Spirit to dwell in our hearts and our minds, to guide us, to make the right choices, to have the right attitude and the words so that we can encourage people around us to look to Jesus by faith. Bless us, Lord, with a practical living out of your love and grace in our lives. Bless us, protect us and our families, our kids, our grandkids, our church. Lord, please use us to give testimony to your goodness and grace so that the world will know that you love them and have provided salvation for them. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a blessed Sabbath day. Enjoy some of the beautiful weather out there. Hopefully you can get down to the beach or go out to some nice spot like Nicene Marks or something and get some vitamin D going. May God bless you during this week, and it has been a pleasure to be with you this morning.